Good morning. What a blessed day we have today with the Free Lutheran Bible College choir here today, and special welcome to you who are visiting. And along those lines, I'm going to give you a few announcements, pray, and then we'll turn it right over to the concert choir and get that started. Just a reminder for us here at church, the Wednesday evenings, we'll still continue with the Lenten services, and Micah Johnson is preaching this week as we continue on with the theme, With Him All the Way. And this afternoon, after the second service, we'll be having a meal together with the choir. And if you are a family member, part of the choir, that way you're invited to stick around for that after the second service. If you'd like to come for that, the choir and the families will go first, and then the rest of the church in that way. And just a reminder of that. Last thing is just a bit of business to make sure we will have an offering during the service here, during the concert. And in your bulletin that you have, in your choir folder here that you have with the service, there is a envelope. If you'd like to give to the Bible College, and you can put it in the offering plate, or there will be an offering plate out back at the end, you can do that this way. There is a QR code as well if you'd like to give to the Bible College. But if you're giving to the church, anything that's not within the envelope will go directly to the church, normal offerings along that way. So just wanted to let you know about that aspect of things. Let's begin with prayer, and we'll turn it over to Mr. Hansen and the Bible College choir today. Lord, thank you for this morning. Thank you for the gift of music. And thank you for the fact that we can praise you in this way, and we can praise you with our life as we live it out. Thank you for our Bible College and for the work that you do through your word there. We pray for the staff, every part of that from the top on down and every bit. We pray for them. We pray for the students. And we ask you that you would be with them over the break here and be with the choir as they travel out west. May your name be lifted up in everything that is said and done. And may people come to know you through your word. We pray these things in your name, Jesus. Amen.
It is a thrill to be with you today. You may see in the program our theme is My Rock and My Redeemer. And as we worship together, we want to praise our Rock and our Redeemer. I invite you to stand and join us in singing our opening hymn, A Mighty Fortress.
Oh, my dear. Thank you. Good morning. My name is Luke Dreiberg, and I'll be giving a short little testimony, I hope, and just a little bit about what God has been working in my life the last couple months, and just the confidence that we can have in Him, even in our in the midst of our doubts. And I have many doubts, and I, as many of us do, and I'm sure many of us do, just the common doubts of a Christian of where is God now is something that's I've been struggling with the last couple months, and just why do we not see God's work in the church as it seems to be in Acts, and just those different things, and just wondering where He's at. And one of this happened to me over Christmas break, and we were watching The Chosen, and there was something in there where Jesus had healed somebody, and I had been confused on why we don't see that anymore. Why don't we see Christians just going out and healing everybody, and why this doesn't happen? And I was like, God, where are you in the world right now? Why do we not see you? And that night for my devotions, I read out of Daniel. And in the stories of Daniel, they've just been taken into exile and all this stuff, and they've been living in a different land when they're slaves. And God comes to Daniel, and Daniel's all confused. He's getting different visions and stuff, and he's confused. And God comes to Daniel, and he says, from the moment that you first repented and turned to me, I have been with you. And even in the midst of all of Daniel's struggles and doubts, God was with him. Even when Daniel couldn't feel it or see it, God was with him. And just another verse that goes with this is Psalm 73:26, which says, my flesh and my heart may fail, but God is my strength and my portion forever. That God is our full strength. And as we talked about in the last song with New Every Morning, when trials come, when fears assail me, your faithfulness and your strength and your confidence that we can have in you is still there. So, thank you.
Place you suffered.
God is our rock, is our fortress, our refuge. And now we look at Christ as our Redeemer.
I'm from Valley City, North Dakota, and so this morning, as we're singing about Christ being our rock and our Redeemer, I want to share with you guys just how he's been my rock and my Redeemer. So I have not always appreciated the blessings that I have in my life. When I was just 2 years old, I was diagnosed with type 1 diabetes, and then when I was 5, I was later diagnosed with celiac disease, which is kind of just a fancy way of saying I can't eat gluten or wheat, whatever. and at the time, when I was 5 years old, it was really kind of just a fad, like it wasn't common. And so both of these things were a daily struggle for me. And even though I actually knew plenty of people with some of the same diseases, it felt as if I was alone, and it seemed like everyone else's problems were just incomparable to mine. If you can imagine, I had plenty of pity parties for myself, and I felt alone and never able to measure up to the standard of happiness that I thought everyone else already just had. And I did not see any purpose in my life. And the only one I turned to was myself, and obviously ourselves are never enough. And so in the living room at my house, we have a verse across the wall. It's Colossians 3:17, and it says, "Whatever you do in word or deed, do all in the name of the Lord Jesus, giving thanks through him to God the Father." I was not very secretive of how discontent I was. Although I didn't walk around complaining to everyone about how difficult my life was. I definitely wasn't living it for the glory of Christ. And so my mom would often lovingly ask me what my problem was. And at one point, she sat me down at some point and asked me why I was always so crabby. And she asked me, don't you see how blessed you are? Don't you see all these other problems in the world that you don't have to deal with? This summer, I was blessed to be on one of the summer teams for the Bible college. And a lot of the time, kids would have the question, well, if Jesus died for me, why are we still on this earth? What is the purpose? Why can't we just go to heaven, I guess? And so this is exactly what my mom explained to me. My mom explained to me that the point of life is to glorify God, so that others can have the same rock and redeemer that I have. That is why we're here. That kind of hit me. I was being so ungrateful. And I tried to just live as perfectly as I could, but that's not enough either, because I can't muster up good godliness from the pure goodness of my heart. It doesn't work that way. And there's no goodness there. I at one point was reading my Bible, and I was reading 2 Corinthians 12, 9 through 10. In these verses, God is talking to Paul when Paul is suffering from his thorn in his flesh. And he says to Paul, my grace is sufficient for you, for power is perfected in weakness. And so Paul says back, most gladly, therefore, I would rather boast about my weakness, so that the power of Christ may dwell in me. Therefore, I am well content with weakness, with insults and distresses, with persecutions, with difficulties, for Christ's sake. For when I am weak, then I am strong. Paul later says in Philippians 4:11 that he's learned to be content in all circumstances that he's in. In my life, I still struggle daily, but I have found assurance in Christ, and the ability to be content comes from him. Every single good thing in me is only because of Christ's work in me. And the purpose of life is, like Colossians 3:17 says, to glorify God in everything we do, so that others might know him. And we do this because Christ died for all of us. This is the purpose God has given us. We are not called to live our lives for ourselves. God calls us to live our life for his glory. And so I want to just leave you guys with a verse that I've taken comfort in over the past year or two, I guess. And it's from Isaiah 26, and it's verses 3 and 4. It says, The steadfast mind you will keep in perfect peace, because he trusts in you. Trust in the Lord forever, for in God, the Lord, we have an everlasting rock.
Oh,
We are going to, if that last song was Lent-related, Croth-related, our next song is going to be Easter-related. We're going to skip over Christmas hymn to keep it within an hour. Come to the next service if you want to hear the songs we skip over. But choir's moving to sections because it's tradition of the school to invite folks that come to sing Hallelujah Chorus with us. If you have sung Hallelujah Chorus before, we would invite you to come join us. We actually have music for you. And at this time, come on forward if you'd like to join us in singing Hallelujah Chorus. On the piano side, we have basses and sopranos. On this side, we have tenors and altos. And then choir, maybe let's adjust this way just a little bit to stay open from the strings and give guests. It is also a tradition of this song to typically stand. And I'll invite you to stand for this and for the congregational hymn, which will immediately follow.
Hallelujah, 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 hallelujah. may be seated. My name is Adam Osier. For those of you who don't know me, I am the dean of the Free Lutheran Bible College. It's been my privilege to serve there for the last, this is my fourth academic year. I get to work with these students and many others as we look at God's Word together. I know this congregation has been a big supporter of the schools, not just in proximity, I think by necessity. You have been. Is this church used to meet on the campus at the college there? Also, you guys have sent many students over the years and have supported us in a variety of ways, so thank you for that. I want to share a little bit of God's Word with you today, and there's so much in the Word, and I want to dig into this more deeply than I can with the time allotted, but I want to look at it together. We're going to look at Psalm 118, but we'll get there in just a second. By the way, Abby, I'm using your Bible. Where are you at? Is that okay? Is that all right? It's always good to have God's Word. It's kind of my safety net, and it's well it should be, right? God's Word. Now, a few years ago, we hosted another pastor's family for dinner one night. Pastor Alex Amiot from Thief River Falls. Some of you know him. That family has the cutest little guy. His name is Ephraim, and he was at that time unable to move, but he was very aware of his surroundings. I love little kids, and I thought maybe he'd come to me, but I terribly misread that situation. As I got up and I reached out to him, Ephraim looked to my six-year-old at that time, daughter Kaya, reached his hands out just about that aggressively because he wanted her to take him. As I leaned down, that horror overtook him. He lunged at Kaya. At the prospect of being taken captive by this ogre, Kaya became Ephraim's rock, his safe space, as we like to use that word today. She was, of course, glad to oblige. Ephraim was very cute. She loved him, and he was very thankful for a trusted hero who would come to his rescue. Psalm 118 is the story of a march to a rock and a refuge. A safe space, safe place. It was a song of praise that was sung as the Jewish people made their pilgrimage to Jerusalem to celebrate the Passover. Its themes tell the story of the love that God has for them, that he was their rock and redeemer. In it, they sang of his love for them, verses 1 through 4. His redemption from their slavery, that he bought them back from slavery, verses 5 through 7. The refuge of his presence, verses 8 through 9. The victory he'd won for them over their enemies, verses 10 to 13. And the salvation that he'd given them, verses 14 through 18. It was their annual remembrance of that rescue as they progressed toward Jerusalem. They would sing this song that God had won for them victory over their Egyptian captors. And then we get in to verse 19. That's where I will read today. Open to me the gates of righteousness, that I may enter through them and give thanks to the Lord. This is the gate of the Lord. The righteous shall enter through it. I thank you that you have answered me, and today have become my salvation. The stone that the builders rejected has become the cornerstone. This is the Lord's doing. It is marvelous in our eyes. This is the day that the Lord has made. Let us rejoice and be glad in it. Save us, we pray, O Lord. O Lord, give us success. Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. We bless you from the house of the Lord. This was their annual reminder of their salvation, but it was also their annual assurance of the ultimate rescue that God was going to provide for them in Jesus the Messiah. It was this psalm, most likely, that God's people were singing when the Messiah finally did come and rescue them. As Jesus rode into Jerusalem for the final Passover of his earthly ministry, this was the song in the lips of the faithful. We call this event, and this is spoken of in Scripture, and we call it Palm Sunday, the triumphal entry of Christ. And we often use the word Hosanna on that Sunday. It will be coming up here in a couple of weeks, right? But that word Hosanna literally is the phrase in verse 26. Save us, O Lord, we pray. That's what Hosanna means. Jesus rode up to Jerusalem, and the people recognized their rescuer, this one who was coming to save them. But what they didn't fully comprehend at that time was how these verses would play out in the week to come. As they progressed into the temple of the Lord, as they marched up to Jerusalem, because anywhere you came from, Jerusalem was up. They marched up into the temple and through the outer courts and into the inner courts. It was like they were singing this song. He was the gate. Open to me the gate of righteousness, that inner court. He was the gate to their righteousness. The righteousness that they failed to possess because of their sin would be theirs through him. They would finally get their righteousness. He was the answer to their cries for salvation. They knew their sin. They felt their oppression. They recognized the absence of safety. They needed to be rescued. He would be their rescuer. Not from the Romans, as they thought, but from a much darker oppressor. Jesus would be that stone that the builders would reject. The builders of the day were these Jewish leaders who promoted a form of self-righteousness that provided no security at all. Jesus would proclaim a different way to God, himself, and they would reject him. Yet, it says in this text that he was the cornerstone. The stone that the builders rejected would actually be the foundation on which every hope would rest. This song was a song of praise for them, a declaration of trust in the one who would redeem, make righteous, and give safe refuge. They only saw, in part, the salvation that he would bring. We now have the full picture. We get to see the fulfillment of what this psalm would be. And with the psalmist, we can say, just as it was in that day, just as it was in Jesus' day, just as it is today, this is the day that the Lord has made. Let us rejoice and be glad in it. We get the full picture of what it means to find our foundation, our refuge on this cornerstone. Like them, we need his righteousness. In ourselves, we lack it. If we took an honest moral inventory of our thoughts, words, and behaviors, we wouldn't argue with that statement. The righteousness that God requires is perfection, and none of us are there. Jesus is the gate to the righteousness we need, that you need, that I need. Like them, we need salvation. If perfection is the goal, and it is according to Scripture, perfect righteous perfection, we're in trouble, but Christ perfectly fulfilled the righteous requirement of the law in our place. He succeeded where we failed. He succeeded where Israel failed. He succeeded where Adam failed. So that as we trust in him, as we place our faith in him, the law that condemns us no longer can. When he stands as our advocate, we're safe. Like them, we need to be established on the cornerstone. Like the builders of ancient Israel, like the religious hypocrites of Jesus' day, we at times reject him. We look to other idols on which to establish our foundation, sometimes money, sometimes relationships or power or prestige or positions in our jobs, promotions, things like that. Quite frequently, it's this false hope that we're better than average, whatever average is. Yet we are called to look to Christ crucified for our sins, as the only thing on which we can build. We are called to lay our failed attempts down at his feet and to trust him. When Ephraim reached out to my daughter that day, his reaction was instant and aggressive. There was no hesitation with Ephraim that day. He knew without question he needed help. He also knew without question where he would be safe, or at least he thought. My hope is that we would as readily know our need for a Savior, recognize that need, and to flee as quickly to the one who has come in the name of the Lord, the cornerstone of this psalm, Jesus Christ. Don't reject him by trying to build your own foundations or by trying to build foundations through good works or other things that aren't going to last. Trust him, thank him, for he is our rock and our Redeemer. Amen. Thank you.
The call to give thanks and to trust is a generational one. God is our rock and our Redeemer is for one. It's been a joy to worship with you this morning, to share. We have one more song before benediction. And as we think of God as our rock, yes, that involves him being our cornerstone, our anchor, and our refuge.
Thank you so much, choir, and what a wonderful way to start a Sunday morning, isn't it? And you guys had it right away. It's new every morning, his faithfulness. Psalm 18, I love you, Lord, my strength. The Lord is my rock and my fortress, my deliverer. My God is my rock in whom I take refuge, my shield and the horn of my salvation, my stronghold. Would you grace us as we leave with the benediction today? Thank you again. Thank you.